Welcome to Sketch Zone Podcast. I'm Carlos. That was Charlie. This week, my friends. Today is going to be an interesting day, y'all, because I literally just got out of the car. And listen.
Oh, you can pull a mic up, huh? Okay.
This show is not brought to you by Taco Bell, but is definitely fueling it. Mmm, those are the nachos. I'm Carlos Gomez. That's Robert.
Hi, Robert. Nice to meet you. I can't wait to see which of us is going to be friends and which of us is going to be enemies.
This is going to be fun.
He's laying out this show for
Robert
you.
Robert Taylor, not only does he have two first names, but he's a writer. He's a professional writer for like DreamWorks and stuff, DreamWorks TV.
It's like a thing.
It's I don't know. Have you guys heard of that place?
I think so.
I've never heard of it.
We're going to figure out.
Actually work there.
We're going to figure out what it takes to be a writer for DreamWorks TV. But before we get to that, that's Charlie B. Williams III.
I'm here. And I have news.
Uh-oh.
But
can we talk about this?
No, we don't do it now. Keep going.
But now I'm
not
like
gonna have anybody yell at me this weekend. No. We have another person introduced.
You can't do that.
See? Monsieur Jacques Casperzac.
I'm here and I have a lot of secrets that I'm gonna spill, but not right now.
This is that like happened. The first season of Twin Peaks, guys. This is so frustrating.
Better than the first season of 6 Feet Under.
Was that a bad season?
So, speaking of Gilmore Girls, just kidding. So, no, for
no,
real.
Please keep going. I love Gilmore Girls. I love Rory. I love Lorelai. Is this what it's about? Is this the Gilmore Girls podcast? Jack, did you lie to me?
We are officially talking about Gilmore Girls.
Yo Robert, you're amazing.
Something tells me we're going to run out of lead when we're writing down show titles on this one.
I like Robert. They want him to come back.
You're just trying to be on his friend list.
No, it's okay. It's good.
He's like, I don't need any more enemies.
Feel free to add me. I'll totally contemplate accepting, Charlie.
Feel free to add me.
Yo, I am not. I don't think I am prepared as witty as Robert is. Okay. I feel like we have.
No, for real. Let's talk about this naked chicken taco.
What? Thing. You can't say that on the show.
But as naked chicken chalupa is what it is. So
I heard it was amazing.
All right, people are talking about
people that. Get upset with me when they say, oh, you know, I'm like, kind of Mexican food is good, but it's not my jam. You got me at Taco Bell and we're good, you know. Give me like $6. I can go get my fill of tasty tacos.
With cheese.
With queso. Queso. And at what point did supreme mean sour cream? I don't know. Americans be bastardizing the hell out of everything they get their hands on. Hashtag welcome Trump. So
wrong. Wait, did you just pull out another sound effect?
They're always wrong.
So yeah, this naked chicken chalupa thing, genius, absolute genius. Because let me tell you why. The shell is made out of chicken. What's no carbs. It's like straight protein to the heart.
Okay, I have a question.
Here we go.
So, I haven't been to Taco Bell in a while. Okay, that's a lie.
You can't just blurt it out like that.
But I haven't been there to see this naked chicken chalupa thing. Is there chicken inside the chicken?
No.
Is it like this weird bastardization of chicken, or is it like there's just lettuce inside of the chicken shell?
I thought there was meat inside the chicken.
You know what? I'm not even going to lie.
You don't even know.
I ate it so fast, I don't even know what was in it. It could have been like toes. I don't know.
I mean,
it is
that
gone.
When you ordered it, what is it? What is...
Wait, you literally don't know?
I don't. You... It had like lettuce, tomatoes, the shell, everything. Like the pocket is made out of like chicken. Not like, well, it's probably not like chicken. It's made out of chicken, but no, it's probably made out of like chicken.
Okay. Because I can't believe your ass sat there and ate a whole chalupa chicken, son, whatever you want to call it. Doesn't it have meat in it? Doesn't it have like beef in it?
It was like the cartoons where you open your jaw, you put it in there, and you slam your jaw shut. That's what just happened to that taco. That taco had no chance.
Carlos, I just met you, and I can safely say that I already have some opinions.
Robert, I'm willing to bet you have opinions about
it. It's not because I'm a brown kid, because you're racist.
Wow. I'm gay. I'm not allowed to be racist.
Good point. Good point. He's got one.
Nice try.
He's got a point there. Robert, I've used that same statement. Just...
You're gay too, Charlie?
Nope. Black. Can't be racist. It's a fact.
Jack. That's right. That's right.
Are we really taping this week? Are we really doing
this? This is live.
Oh, yeah.
We're live right now.
Okay. I literally just, not literally, because it was probably about 10 minutes ago. 10 minutes ago, I ran out of the car with a bag full of Taco Bell. And I'm
okay,
seriously.
Okay, I also have a follow-up question. So you know that you're about to do a podcast, and you chose Taco Bell.
He did.
Like, what happens in 15 minutes when you get the shits?
No, iron stomach.
I go on mute. I go on mute and I let these guys carry the show.
We take over, yeah.
Okay, I got you.
Unique pass-off system.
It's like the old school DJs. They used to play the really long songs when they had to go pee. Yeah. Yeah.
It's like if you see his avatar come up,
it goes away.
That's how American Pie became like a big hit. They were like, I got 8 minutes. I can make it to the toilet and back. Everything will be fine. And then it suddenly became a movement. And in more ways than one.
A movement.
A mom movement.
I like what you did
there.
See
what I did there?
I like what you did there.
Man. That guy, he must be a writer because he's pretty clever with the words.
Yeah. That's why they pay me the mediocre bucks, guys.
Hey, wait. They pay you mediocre? Man, I need a raise.
Writers always get the good stuff.
Carlos,
huh?
you ate a chicken taco. No meat.
We're still talking about the tacos?
Just chicken. I just wanted to I provide a link. He inhales food without looking at it. Could be a problem in the future, but
probably about 15 minutes.
Yeah, just a chicken taco. No meat in it. It's just sour cream chicken.
That makes sense.
Cream chicken. Yeah,
that's what it looks like. Let me tell you, it's a lot smaller than I thought it would be. It
always is. That's what she.
Yeah, that's what she said. Yeah, it's a lot smaller than it, and I'm already hungry again.
Did it look good, though? Did it look as good as that picture?
Oh, dude, it was tasty. Everything Taco Bell makes. Taco Bell and Mexican food is like the Midas touch. They just touch chicken, and it curls up and then fills itself with taco stuffings. And then you just throw it in your face.
Well, you know, in the future, we're going to really have to break you of this Mike Chubb. Eat while we do a podcast type of situations that you've been doing.
Listen, this is what? Episode 94? 94 episodes, and this is the first one that I've had to eat.
No, you ate last week.
Did I?
Yes.
Can I also just say that I'm very fucking pissed off that I'm not episode 100? I'm already just furious at all of you. Except for Charlie. I kind of like Charlie.
See, he keeps throwing it in your face of what episode it is, but it's okay. Maybe we can have you back as like, hey, it's 100. Bring back our best guest.
You know, see no how pressure, you. Well, let's see how the rest of no the
pressure.
Show
but if you're funny, we can actually have you back as like if you're funny. Doing something. Do you juggle?
No.
No.
No, but he drinks Moscow Mules. Look at that.
Hell yeah, dude.
Cheers.
Cheers.
You're coming back to episode 101.
Wow. One. Guest star.
Yeah. That episode. See, now whoever's going to be on that episode is going to feel a certain type of way. We might have to have one by ourselves.
Hey, if you're listening to this train wreck and you have a question for anyone on this panel, feel free to use the Sketch Zone hotline. It's 408-753-8248. That's 408-SKETCH-8. If you have any questions for anyone on the show.
Cool.
I'm trying to pull up the... Someone is trying to send us messages on YouTube. Can you guys see that? No. So now that we have all that underway and Robert is wondering what the hell is going on with his life, how's everyone's week happening? Charlie, do you have anything you want to spill before we go in on
Robert? What's this news?
Well, I've kind of regressed back, I guess I would say, in the last week to a more primitive form of myself. I have become a student again. over at CGMA, CG Masters Academy, which is through.
How's that going?
It's going good. I'm taking a new class, so to brush up on the skills and become a compositor and add to my 3D knowledge, so I can be have full control over my shots. It's going pretty good. We know some people have taken classes over there. I know some people have taken classes over there, and we know people's over there, so it's good to be on the other side to kind of see. And it's taken a couple months to find the right place. It seems like it's pretty good so far. I'm pretty critical since I'm a teacher also, so I probably have a lengthy email that I'll send over once I'm done. But it's going good so far. The instructor's really good, works in the industry. Mr. Nick Dubar is really good, and he's doing good so far. I like it. So yeah, I just wanted to tell that to you guys, and I'll tell you guys how it's going to be each week.
Now, when you say lengthy email, do you mean like 500 words or less, or do you mean 2,000 words or less, or do you mean 5,000 plus? Just give me an idea so I can define you as a person.
Two sentences.
5,000 plus. I tend to talk and ramble.
Shut up. 5,000 plus in an email?
Hey, it could be a book. Maybe 3 grand, maybe somewhere in there, 2 to 3 grand. Who knows? We'll see how it goes. If I really like the class, it might be longer, and then I might evangelize it and take it on the road.
More importantly, Ryan Brockmeyer says, I tried one the other day, meaning the chicken.
Oh, going back to tacos.
He tried one the other day, and it was actually wasn't that bad. Why do you say it like that?
Wasn't that
only lettuce and cheese and sauce. Oh yeah, tomatoes. But I got it without, because Ryan doesn't really like tomatoes. Meat is the shell, Charlie.
Well, duh. I looked it up for you, not me. I knew what it was. But okay, Ryan, sure. Thanks.
So before we go any further, another monster hit. The Doritos Locos Taco.
I told you that one was good.
I have another serious question for the group.
Here we go.
How many tacos do we think he has waiting to be eaten slowly going to get eaten over the course of the next? How long is this thing going to be? 4 hours?
No, this is my last one.
He's probably had 3 to 4, I would say.
All right, well, while Carlos is eating.
Yeah, he can't talk now. Let's take it over, yeah.
So hang on. Charlie, you said you're going back to be a student, and you were a teacher. Robert,
yeah,
you were also a student and a teacher. So Go ahead.
What? No, please. I felt like you were going into a question, so I was clearing my throat, but you thought I wanted to say
I was going to say, what does it feel like becoming a teacher that of which you were just taught?
Well, I went to the American Film Institute Conservatory and got my master's in screenwriting, and since then I taught for 2 years at Woodbury University in Burbank, and now I'm starting at the New York Film Academy teaching screenwriting. I really, really love it. The thing that I think is really important for people who are going into teaching, and Charlie, if you agree or disagree, feel free to jump in. Mm-hmm. But I think that one of the most important things is being able to give notes properly, because certain people only respond to notes in certain ways, and sometimes you have to baby people, sometimes you have to be blunt, otherwise they just won't get it. And whereas the stuff that you're teaching is universal, the way that you implemented it with specific students is different from person to person, and the sooner people recognize this, the better teacher I think they are, personally. And I wish that, I love going to the American Film Institute. I met a couple of the best teachers who I've ever had in my 31 years of existence, but I wish that other teachers would take that more to heart.
I fully agree with that. I think, with another colleague that I taught with, that we've had on the show in the past, we ended up having a lot of different students. I taught in downtown Chicago, which was a weird melting pot of your stereotypical Abercrombie-looking model, someone that's a lot more hood, and then everyone in between. So you had a lot of different learning abilities in your classroom. And I taught a bunch of artists, so ADD ran rampant. But I would have to do different versions of the same lecture, right? Some people responded to the live demos. Other people responded to me physically writing on the board and Venn diagramming things out. Other ones responded to me after class. I've even had to do stuff for ones that were visually impaired. So I did audio versions of my lectures and through like Google Hangouts and stuff like that, where they would listen to me in the evenings. I've done a bunch of different ways. And it was frustrating when other teachers didn't go that far, you know, and this was just in a small game design degree in the communications section of the college I taught at. So yeah. And then you have other students that think if you just hand out a tutorial and then tell them to do homework, everybody will get the same results. So I do feel like going above and beyond is good.
You both teach creative outlets.
How was the taco, by the way, buddy?
Oh, dude, magic. Is there similarities to teaching a writing class versus a 3D class? Like getting kids to think outside the box or something?
Well, I have never taken a 3D class, but I would think that the thing that unites us is trying to figure out a way where the classes and the specific creative outlet is personalized. Mm-hmm. Because it's so easy to do just the minimum amount and basically create, you know, a Michael Bay movie or dog food or whatever it is, or a Michael Bay movie that is dog food, which is all of them. Sorry, ooh, do you have any Transformers fans? I apologize. Jack. Go ahead. Jack, no. I love you.
I think you're totally right, though. Like, maybe not a 3D class, Carlos, but I would think I've taught in a bunch of, like, intro to design for gaming and stuff like that, where we talk about building a story and, you know, we talk about the hero's journey and stuff like that and how you can build story arcs through game design. You know, I don't know. There's some similarities there. Yeah.
It's all about figuring out ways to personalize it. and to bring a specificity that you couldn't find elsewhere through other means. If it was anyone else, they would tell the story essentially the same, but it's the devil's in the details. Mm-hmm. There's only the seven main plots, but there's an infinite amount of details, and keying into that, I think, is stupendous. When someone finally clicks in, you can see their voice being heard. It's one of the most miraculous, delightful things, and it's actually fun to see and hear over and over again. Did I just go deep? I didn't mean to. I'm so sorry.
Keep going deep.
Oh, no, please. Hey,
go Robert, deep. How long have you taught before we get to the next question? How long have you been teaching?
I taught for 2 years at Woodbury, and I'm in my first year at NYFA.
Cool. Oh, have you come across a student that you're like, man, he's really talented, and like, you know, you see the whole light bulb go off in their head, and like their work is exceptional?
Yes. Nice. It's nice. Wonderful when that does happen, and it's fantastic to sort of be there on the ground floor and see them at the beginnings and just know that they have what it takes to blossom into something super duper awesome. As bad as that metaphor is, and I so apologize, and Jack, don't mock me. I see you mocking me with your eyes.
Yeah, those judgmental eyes.
But, I mean,
I mocker.
There's a moment, and it's wonderful when you get them and you're like, wow, this person already has what it takes, but it's even better and it's even more sweet when we're halfway through the semester, two-thirds of the way through the semester, and they finally click in and get it, and you're just like, wow, finally, thank fucking God. I'm allowed to curse, right?
Yes, you are.
No. Yeah. This is live.
Okay. No, this is live.
Unless your mom is watching.
No, that's the part I always have deaf teachers. It's because those points in time are few and far between, but at the same time, I love in the middle of a class when I see somebody actually get it, you know, and so, then you see them improve.
So, like, what's the – I've been in a bunch of visual classes, and Charlie and Carlos have, and, like, when you're reviewing a student's work or even your own work, you can actually hold it up in a panel and see the progress. That's clearly, like, a little bit different when you're talking about somebody who's writing, because it's – you have to absorb it, and then it's just kind of in your head. So how does that manifest when you're trying to describe or compare? Like, you're kind of left to your own memory, aren't you?
Well, whenever I'm looking at the way students have executed notes, this is a little, I'm going to get to the answer to your question in about 2 minutes.
Charlie does this all the time.
Okay, perfect.
But we always get there, though, and it's a beautiful journey.
That's true.
So I think that this is probably a little bit different than CG classes, but specifically for writing, there are four types of people who give notes, and there's only one type of person that you should listen to. And 98% of the people who are giving notes to you are one of the three shitty types. The first This is something where I tell all of my students the very first day of class, I throw out the warning and then it often doesn't work. But the first type of person is the type of person who's going to read your script and is just not going to understand fundamentally what you're going for. They're going to be the ones who are like, why does the asteroid have to be coming to Earth? Why are the machines talking? Oh my God, why does he want to kill people? You know, you just have to fucking ignore them. The second type of person is the type of person who is happy to give notes but hates the genre you're working in. So the notes are going to be fundamentally shit. Sometimes you can listen to the character stuff because character stuff is universal. But why would I listen to someone who's giving notes on a Western script who hates the searchers? It's a little idiotic. Mm-hmm. The third type of person who gives notes is the most insidious. And that's the type of person who thinks that they're helping, but in doing so, they're trying to shape your vision into theirs. They love your idea so much that, hey man, I think you should do it this way because this is how I would do it. And it's great that your idea is wonderful and your script's good, but it's not their movie, it's your movie. And then the fourth type of person who gives notes, is the type where you can listen to them. It's the type of person who says, this is what I think you're going for, and this is how I'm going to help you get there. And that's so rare. When you find them, just grab onto them and keep going. And I try and sort of get that going with my students. I try and get that type of honesty. And often they do fall into those little traps, but I like to think that sometimes they're a little more mature and they do learn that sort of thing. Jack, what was your question?
That's good.
Have you ever?
Well, whatever the question was, that was a damn good answer.
We can lead off. We can spawn off into
wherever. Gilmore Girls.
Yes, come back to
Gilmore Girls. Here's a side question to that question was, when you say notes, just for our viewers, how does one give notes on a script? Is this just an overall thing? Is there like a set way to give notes, you know? I'm just going off the lingo so that people understand.
The way that I like to give notes is if it's the first draft that I'm getting, I normally like to give more macro notes. I like to give structural notes, specifically the first time. Once they have the structure down pat, usually around the second or third draft, I give smaller notes, mostly character-based notes, action sequences or action scenes where the choreography doesn't quite make sense, doesn't quite land. And then the third round of notes, which is usually the fourth or fifth draft, I dive in and do dialogue beats, punctuation, spelling, grammar, that type of thing. The way I like to do it is I just bring it up in Adobe and comment and stamp and do fun stuff like that. With witticisms. So that they don't cry when I have to pierce them.
I love this dude. Oh my God.
So let's go back to when Robert was trying to figure out if he was a writer or not. Did you always want to be a writer when you were a kid?
Yep.
Yeah? Were you the kind of kid that would tell
stories? I did not want to be a writer.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Was it always production writing, or was it novel or short story or poem? Or
I love writing everything. Jack, you don't know, but I actually self-published my own novel when I was an undergrad. Don't read it. It's horrible.
What is it called? What is it called?
No.
Well, how am I going to read it then, Robert?
I just said don't is how.
You can't drop a bomb like that. And
it's okay. I'll just have my assistant Google find it for me.
But anyway, I actually love writing for each of the different mediums. I love writing animated. I love writing television. I love writing film. I love writing theater. I love writing comics. I love writing novels, and there's different things that you can do in different mediums that you, there are certain things you can only do on stage, whereas there are only things you can do in comics. There are only things that you can do in animation, and I love embracing those differences, the strengths of each medium, and sometimes breaking down the little borders between the two. It's really fun. It's delightful. I had never written animation before the show that I'm currently on, and it's wonderful.
Is your approach in each one of those concentrations the same?
It always, always, always comes down to the characters. I have to come up with interesting characters. Even if I come up with a log line with a fantastic hook for a story, it's not really a story until I come up with the characters themselves. And the characters can basically interchangeably exist within any medium, but once I come up with who the character is, I need to figure out, oh hey, this one might be better as a novel because I need to get in their mind a lot, or this one's a talker, so I should put him on stage where he can do a lot of monologues. So that's really how I shape it. Thank you for the question. That was a great question. I'm not going to say I'm surprised. I'm just going to leave it there.
I really like this guy.
Keeping you on your toes, Carlos.
I know, jeepers. What? tell us a story about that teacher that that you found inspiration from and that actually told you, I know where you want to go. This is how I'm going to help you get there.
Well, I've been lucky enough to have a couple of those. I'll name drop. Well, they're not listening, so I don't have to name drop them. My favorite teacher that I've ever had is Jim Hosney or Mike Urban, but the one who I think I learned the most from is Marta Kauffman. I had a class with her at AFI. You guys would know her because she co-created that TV show, little show called Friends. And she currently is the creator on Grace and Frankie, which is on Netflix.
Oh, that's a great
and hers was such where she would walk in and she would just be having normal conversations about anything. And she would drop bombs of excellence that you would figure out about storytelling and just be like, oh my God, that changed everything that I could have ever thought about the craft of storytelling. And she's like, did I? Oh, surprise.
Did I do that?
And it's one of those things where being in her class was an absolute pleasure. And despite the fact that she obviously is a very busy woman who also did not need to teach, she, because she's got the bling bling, she still took the time to talk to not just me, but all of the students, break down the pilots that we were writing, and figure out ways for our specific voices to come through. So she was definitely up there amongst my favorite teachers ever, and she's genuinely possibly the smartest person I've ever met.
Nice.
I like how all that came just through conversation. You know, these things just happen naturally in the class every day. Probably made you want to go to class every single day and then stay even after, you know.
Yeah, there was this one week when I was at AFI where I just decided I was going to skip every class because I never skip class. And I decided, I'm just going to skip for an entire week. And hers was the only class that I went to over the course of that week.
Nice. At what point did the restraining order come into effect?
Well, it didn't because I was a writer's assistant on Grace and Frankie at the very beginning. So it hasn't yet. She still likes my stuff on Facebook. Every now and then.
That's awesome. What was your first big break?
This show. It's the first show that I've ever actually written on. I mean, I worked on a couple small things.
Awesome.
I know. So yes, the show that I can not talk about because it hasn't been really formally announced anything other than the name is my first big break, but when I can talk about it, I'm going to have a lot to say.
Nice.
I'm going to be like Charlie. I have an announcement, but you'll find out in 6 months.
Boom. You'll be better for it once you listen to hear it. So, yeah. Nice.
Can I ask you guys a question?
Of course.
Go ahead.
So what is your favorite television series, and then what's a TV show that you fucking hate? Because let's be honest, you learn just as much about someone's personality by knowing what they dislike as what they like.
What I really hate.
There's so many that I enjoy, and the reason is I appreciate the effort, you know. It helps me unplug and it helps me. I refuse to think that so many people went into making a show and so many people went into making movies and stuff. And then you just sit there. We talk about it on this show all the time. You just sit there saying, ugh, I cannot believe that smoke was so fake, you know. So I try to appreciate things for the efforts. Lately, I have been getting into that. What is that? Grace and Frankie. I think that show is really good. What else? I started watching, what's the one where the, it was the, it's the alternate United States. If the Nazis,
Man in the High Castle.
Man in the High Castle. That's really good.
That Frank Spotnitz, pretty talented writer.
Yeah, pretty much anything Netflix. You just put on Netflix and it just hit random, and it's going to be magic. They're killing it.
And then what do you hate? What do you just fucking want to die?
Almost anything reality show-ish.
Hmm.
Almost anything reality show. And it's a deeper meaning. Like I hate to think that there's people watching, you know, the Kardashians just to look at their, at the Kardashian life, when you could be out there making your own life as interesting as you find theirs.
What if they just watched it for entertainment, though?
That, and if you do that, then I get it. But there's people that, again, I've watched, I've found myself watching it before and be like, oh my God, that's so crazy. But to set my DVR to it, you'll never see that happen.
Exactly.
Because there's a time and a place for that type of entertainment. But to seek it out, the best thing for me that ever happened was binge watching. Cause I can focus. I just push through the entire season.
In 8 to 10 hours.
Yeah. And then my eyes don't close cause they're dried open. What else? Another one that I'm actually looking forward to, it comes out this weekend, is Walking Dead. Been watching that.
I feel like Jack has an opinion about your opinion.
Yeah, he does, but whatever. I like it. It is pretty cyclical, but I like now they actually have what's his face in there, who walks around?
Negan.
Yeah. They have Negan walking around talking to a bat. I'm like, that's good stuff right there. I like that kind of crazy. If you're just crazy, like kicking puppies and stuff, you need to die. If you talk to bats, we got something to talk about.
Keep you around. Okay.
How about you guys?
You want to go, Jack?
Let's see. Absolutely hate is pretty easy. I really hate Grey's Anatomy.
Nice.
I really hate it. Like, if it's on, I gotta go.
Hilarious.
That music on the show actually has a tendency to be really cool.
Yeah, the music's pretty good. And you know what? In full disclosure, season one and season two were not bad. They were completely watchable. And then something happened, and now it's just ungodly painful.
Hilariously, I was just watching Grey's Anatomy.
I am now on the enemy list.
Let me toss this one in there real quick. Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
Oh, I love Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
Yeah, so good. Sorry, Jack.
Haven't gotten into that one yet.
I forgive you.
It's not a TV show, though.
Oh, yes, it is.
It's not? Yeah, it is.
It is.
Oh. You know what I was thinking of? My Super Ex-Girlfriend.
With that terrible movie I worked on?
Yes. It's what I was thinking of.
I disagree with you there. That was entertainment. When she picks up a shark and throws it at him, that's good stuff. That's good stuff.
Didn't see it coming. Definitely didn't see it coming. Okay. So that's what you hate. What do you like, Jack?
Of all time, I still think I have to say I Love Lucy. But currently,
Honeymooners.
Currently stuff, everything's so dark. Like like Luther was really good, and
great.
Black Mirror, of course, was really good, but it's also like heavy and dark.
Jack, yeah. How have we never bonded over the fact that we both love I Love Lucy?
I don't know, actually. But we found out that we both love Sister Act.
And Sister Act 2, Back in the Habit, and Ghost.
I'll give you that, because you can't not watch a Sister Act if you see it on a Saturday afternoon. Sister Act, you the watch the whole one.
It's so good.
You sit there and watch the whole one, no matter where they are.
Executed. Yeah.
Yeah. Dolores Van Cartier is one of the best movie names of all time.
Mm-hmm.
That's a pretty awesome name.
Pretty awesome name.
The hilarious thing is I have seen the movie so many times that I am probably 60% quotable. I mean, I can do all of the bits where she's like, we once had a hooker living next door named Buckwheat Birth and all that shit. Yep. I also have the original soundtrack recording of the musical.
Yes. Version,
which was randomly written by Alan Menken, who did The Little Mermaid.
Wow, really?
Really random.
And it's wonderful. Oh, how I laughed. It was great. What's your favorite I Love Lucy episode, Jack?
This is a tough one, but I would have to say...
Wait, we'll say it at the same time, and then we'll see if it's the same
I'll count to three.
No, wait, hang on.
Let me know when you're ready.
Yeah, we got to do this right.
I got to make sure
while he's doing while he's doing whatever he's doing, I will show you how much I love Lucy. Oh, I have two dogs, Ricky and Lucy.
Aww.
Ricky is Havanese, which is a little Cuban dog, and Lucy is a big knucklehead that gets in trouble all the time.
I'm going to go with that.
Yeah.
Are you ready, Jack?
Okay, go.
Ready? One, two, three.
Hollywood at last.
Pioneer Women.
Oh, Pioneer Woman is wonderful. That's probably my number three.
Hollywood at Last is pretty damn good.
Hollywood at Last.
What's your second?
Hang on. Mine is Meet a Vita Vegemix.
Yeah, that one's good. Meet a Vita
Vegemin.
Classic for a reason.
My second favorite one is this very weird one that no one has seen, which is also one of the Hollywood ones. It's when they're driving across the country and they have to stay in this little hick hotel in Ohio. Yeah.
Everyone's seen this. With the train?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, with the train that keeps going by. Oh, it opens with one of the best sustained things where they're looking at the signs and each sign is saying you have to try
pecan pralines.
And it lasts for 8 minutes and then it's closed. And then when they get to the little shit hotel, which is in Ohio, and yes, we have tons of hotels like that. The train, I just love it so much. Vitamin Vegemin is up there too, as is the Italian movie, of course. The one that I don't quite get the love for is the chocolate conveyor belt. That scene itself is classic, but the rest of the episode is just sort of fine.
Yeah. How about when they're on the when they have to sing My Bonnie Flies Over the Ocean and then they spray each other with the seltzer water?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's the game show.
Yeah.
That was a funny one.
Charlie, are you a big fan or are you just being quiet because you're tired?
I am an okay fan of Lucy. My parents.
What you're saying is I want to move the conversation to me and my likes and dislikes.
No. I'm listening. Lucy is a classic. I have nothing against it. I'm just waiting my turn.
You're way too nice. Just embrace your opinions.
Oh, you don't want that. We'll be here all night. Which one should I start with? Weird. I'll start with my dislikes. I'm a type of person where I love to go to movies. I love cinema, but I love to detach and watch. So while I'm not going to watch a shitty movie on purpose, I don't get overly critical of movies or TV shows. I just don't watch them if they're not good. So with that being said, only thing that really doesn't interest me at all that I would literally fall asleep on is I can't stand Walking Dead at all. In zombie culture.
I know you sometimes.
All together.
I don't get the zombie culture either.
I don't. You can go with video games. I think it's a tired, very, 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 very weak design mechanic when you do those. Because it's like, I am the type of person that when I either make games or design games, they have to be something smart and they want to challenge the player. And I don't want to do horde mode and bring, and it's like a shoot ducks in a barrel against stupid people. And I tried to get into like the whole Walking Dead thing and get into the characters and because they had that, remember when they had, not last year, but the year before last, when right before the season came on, they had that crazy like marathon where you can like totally get caught up. I'm one of those dudes that tried to do that marathon and I was done after like 4 or 5 episodes.
I thought you were going to say 15 minutes.
No, I tried. I gave it a good try, but I was like, this is stupid. I don't know.
I feel like even if you dislike The Walking Dead in general, and I do think that there is a point to those who are like, it does get absolutely repetitive because, of course, they can never actually find Haven. There's never going to be a happy ending. You're just going to keep watching them until they're all dead. But I think that the pilot for The Walking Dead is miraculous.
That was good.
Yeah,
no, that was good. Yeah.
Specifically is one of the best hours of TV I've seen.
Yeah, that's when I started with. I was like, okay, cool, maybe I was wrong. And then I got tired of being like, huh. For the same reason, one of my favorite TV events that I loved was Lost, when it first came out, right? And I watched the whole thing. Yeah.
And then you hated yourself.
Yeah, because I hated the ending. I got really, really into it. And I'm the type of person where we had people at work that we were all on the sites, and I got into it even more than I really wanted to. But like, I loved watching it, and I fell in love with certain characters. You know, there's a dude on there named Charlie. I hated him in the beginning. Kind of understood him halfway through, and I was like, and then was rooting for him at the end. You know, like, well, before he met his demise or whatever. But like,
wait, Charlie dies? No, I'm kidding.
Kind of.
Spoiler alert.
Does any of them ever really die? No. And all the other characters, you know, Mr. Echo, all the other ones that I thought I was going to be like one-dimensional, and they end up being really, really good. Remember the pilot? I keep going back to the pilot episode of Lost. Mm-hmm. And the first couple episodes went into that first season. And I was like, Carlton Cuse and all those dudes, like, yeah, they're doing something good. I think it's going to be amazing. And then it got weird in the middle. I was like, and I kind of got the whole, like, Walking Dead thing. I was like, they need to pick this up. And then it got really weird. Then it got almost incoherent. Like, okay, what's going on? Really? Like, where's the monster shit that I really wanted, you know? And then, oh, it's not? It's some weird machine? Whatever. So for one reason why it let me down.
Real quick before I forget, mostly when you were talking about your emotional bond to this Charlie guy, you know who does a really good job of pushing and pulling characters in and out of your heart? Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. And I'm dead serious, because what was it, towards the last part of first season, I was like, you're just a selfish bitch. God damn it. I was so done with her. And then they turn it around and you're like, oh, you're just a fragile flower. I just want to hug you until the pain.
Okay, I don't know anything about this show. All right. Is this really about an ex-girlfriend?
Yes.
Yes.
And you're really
into what's crazy is
it's wonderful.
Yeah.
But let's talk.
Tarzan actually wrote it too.
Huh. It's a thing where, have you seen the second season yet, Carlos?
I just started it.
Well,
probably about 3 or 4.
Vague spoiler alert. I don't think that this will hurt you in any way.
Yeah.
But they take the character of Valencia, who you hate in the first season. She's the one who's engaged to Josh. Mm-hmm. And the stuff that they do with her character in season two and any other show would have just ditched her to the side of the road. Because she's not really useful anymore. They bring her back, and they bring her back in such an interesting way that
I've seen the episode where she's helping plan things.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I completely agree. They go deep.
The other thing is, it's one of the most, the second season, and I'm not sure at these episodes yet, it has one of the most interesting dissections of friendship I've ever seen on television, and the gives and takes of friendship, the push pull, the alpha, the really Jack, really motherfucker.
That was a legit cough. That was not a commentary on anything at all. That was
you couldn't have chosen the cough when Charlie was talking.
Jack likes you. Sorry.
You know what, Jack? I'm gonna pick this moment to go to the bathroom. This is why I'm
he's
so
not,
upset.
And he's not going to mute, and he's taking his laptop with him. Oh, yeah.
Thank you for reminding me to mute. I'll be back in approximately 40 to 50 seconds, depending on how it goes.
Okay. Good luck.
Thank Wash you. I mean, I didn't have Taco Bell for dinner, so I'm sure I'll be fine.
Yeah. No, but speaking of that, while he goes, Have you guys ever watched the show, which called? Oh, I just lost it. Oh no!
For the record, this is the first time in history that the guest has actually gotten up and gone to the bathroom. Jack, we should Jack just sit here and talk about him. Like, no. Who the hell?
I just made him leave. I know, and I know. I totally mute all the time because I have a cough, Jack, and I almost did that earlier. So he did it, and then he actually called you on it. My heart stopped.
Oh, come on now.
Sorry, Charlie. What show were you talking about?
But anyway, HBO. HBO's had some really good ones. We should mention Sopranos. You know, and then also the other one that really is good to me, which I don't know if a lot of people watch because they didn't renew the season, is called, which is my favorite show, one of my favorite shows series. It's called How to Make It in America. If you have not watched it, it's starring a relatively new cast plus Kid Cudi, but it takes place in New York City, and it talks about these loops of friends in New York City that are trying to make it, but they're creative. A lot of them are creative in different ways. It's talking about they're trying to start a clothing line. And I don't know why I liked it. Some people thought it was just okay, but I feel like it's excellent. And I related to a lot of the different characters in it, just in terms of because they were so creative, they're trying to start a clothing line. They're going to different, fabric shops, and but it's all spun in this like really trendy like type of like, New York City vibe show, which is really good. So if you haven't heard of the series, it's not on anymore. But go find it.
How many seasons was it on?
I think one or two.
That's it.
I think so. Well, it's HBO, so it was a little bit different, but yeah.
Did they end each season, like kind of wrap up that story, or at least?
I think it was supposed to keep going, and it kind of abruptly ended. That's what I think. Which is
speaking of endings, Charlie, you were talking about Lost,
right?
Feelings on the ending. Mm-hmm. Feelings on the ending of Lost, because that's always it depends on who you talk to. It's a
no. I think it was such a juggernaut that like it was doomed to get hate no matter how it got. But to me, it got really metaphysical and symbolism and all that stuff that for some of the audience, it probably went over their head and they were upset. But then again, I think Lost is on a trend of losing audiences each time they had some type of weird reveal that wasn't what people's imagination thought it was. Mm-hmm. So, it was, I think after a while, it was a slow bleed anyway, because, you had this whole thing in your head of what this was, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, it's only this. And I seen it at my job, you know, at the studio I was working at the time, where we had literally a good 50 people on an email thread back in the day, like talking about it every Monday. That yeah. thread, slowly people would start removing their names, and it was like 10 people at the end of the season, you know? So, like, I feel like, you know, it was just a story of people, like, slowly. And sometimes I think maybe the general public could be a little stupid.
So, well, but generally speaking, you know, yes. But, you know, like, let's talk about, like, the enigma that is endings in series television. I mean,
right.
for the most part, I mean, these shows are designed to go forever and ever, as long as they'll keep making money. Obviously, right. there's exceptions, shows that are written to wrap up, or, you know, wrap up in small sections and leave certain. But, like, how do we expect anything out of a show? And Robert, you should certainly comment on it. How do we expect anything out of a show that is designed to kind of last? How do you end something like that appropriately? Like, I mean, I think Lost is a good example. Sopranos is a great example of kind of an ending that people didn't either loved or hated.
Yeah.
Seinfeld is a famous ending that, you know, so many people hate. It's like, how do you end a series properly? And is there a way to do it?
I think they used to.
I mean, I. By the way, I'm back. I've missed some of you.
Here we go.
That said, I think it's much more difficult for comedies to come up with a good finale as opposed to dramas. There are some classic comedic series finales. But that tends to happen in comedies where you can feel the characters maturing over the course of the series. Mary Tyler Moore, for example, has one of the best series finales of all time, but as you watch the show, her life visibly changes over the course of the 7 seasons. Rhoda leaves, Phyllis leaves, she moves apartments, Betty White comes in. So there's always a feeling of life changing and ebbing and flowing, whereas specific comedies where nothing seems to ever change. I'm thinking here specifically of, well, we talked about Isle of Lucy. Like, there's no way that they could have come up with a series finale for Isle of Lucy because is Lucy going to die? I mean,
Ricky gets deported.
Oh, dear
she
Lord.
She finally gets a show in Ricky's, she gets his part in Ricky's show.
Well, she always got a part in Ricky's show.
I know.
She always complains, but she did. Ricky needed to call her on her shit. Dramas, it's different because here's one of the things that people don't tell you who are writing TV shows, which is when they write those pilots and start that first season, they really have no fucking idea what the show actually is. The show's going to turn into what the show turns into.
Right.
And you can have an idea of how it's supposed to end, but there's no fucking way that the show that you originally envisioned when you start your pilot is going to be the show that ultimately you have at the end, no matter what Matt Wiener says. I do think that there are shows where early-ish they figured out this is what I want to do. Breaking Bad, for example. I feel like they had the idea of how they were going to end it and where the characters would be fairly early on. Gilmore Girls famously said, okay, here's what it's going to be, and even though it took a Netflix revival to get there, they got there. And other shows like West Wing, of course, it's built into the DNA of the show that it's beginning with a president, the show would end with the next president coming in. That said, it's almost difficult to come up with a perfect series finale because it's either going to be too maudlin or too nasty to the characters. And someone is going to end up sad and annoyed and very pissed off that Jack Bauer just got kidnapped instead of living happily ever after with Chloe, who we know that he should end up with. The end.
So real quick, we have Fitzy Fitzmaurice who said, what about 6 Feet Under? Now that's a great season finale.
Yeah, 6 Feet Under series finale. Again, it's in the show's DNA that, oh, hi, Fitzy. I adore you, by the way. But it's in the show's DNA. Everyone dies. So what a perfect way to end the show. Everyone dies.
Yeah.
Other ones like The Wire and I think old school shows did it well, you know. I'm thinking of The Cosby Show.
I don't know though.
Well, but before we go down that road, I wanted to get perspective from.
Oh, we're on the road. We're like 4.5 miles down the road, bro.
Yeah. Where have you been?
Are you a fan of a set storyline, tell the story with the finale, or are you more of a fan of like the soap operas, the story that never dies?
I think personally, and it's different for most shows, but personally, I would prefer that each season tell a story. I'm a fan of the Joss Whedon style. Here is my arc for the season. At the end of the season, they can have a couple character cliffhangers, but the story is essentially told. We, however, live in an era where the writers say, oh, fuck, we might not get renewed. Let's just toss everything at the wall and dare the network to pick us up. And then the first 3 or 4 episodes of the next season always tends to be picking up the pieces. Did I give us all something to think about, or did I just sound stupid and no one knows how to respond?
No.
Note that Carlos didn't say anything.
No,
you're stupid.
I my head was bouncing up and down in contemplation. Yes, that is a thoughtful answer. Thank you. And then I started reading the text here. So Fitzy Fitzmaurice says, adore you too, brother. True story 271 or 278. While you were talking about each season telling a story, I was trying to remember, what is it?
True Detective?
True Detective. Season 1 was amazing. Season 2, not so much. What did you guys think about that?
I didn't watch
it. I think that the writer had years to come up with season 1. And I think that I don't know anything about the background of the show itself, so this is all conjecture. But I feel like they hired Woody Harrelson and Matthew McConaughey, who had very specific ideas for what they wanted to do with the characters, which aids in the writing. It always does if they have a specific vision as well. And I believe that the director who directed, I think it's this masterpiece that's no one's seen, which is the newest version of Jane Eyre, which he just does it as a horror movie. He also had a specific vision, and it was one of those things where it really is just lightning in a bottle. Everything worked. And then in the second season, I think that it was rushed. I think that he didn't have – the guy said that the first season had been in development for 3 or 4 years. This one he had 6 months to turn around. He basically created the characters and then cast the actors once everything had been in place. And also it was a question of how – close he should keep the second season to the spirit of the first season. And every one of the viewers was expecting it to be the first season, so there's going to be pushback from that initially. And then there's just the fundamental question of, at no point in the season, and I do think that there are some good things in season 2, specifically Rachel McAdams' performance, but have we all seen season 2?
Yeah.
Can any of you guys tell me specifically, at any given point, what were they investigating?
No.
And what were the 3 specific clues that led them there? Because I actually don't know, and I watched the entire season.
I know that it starts with the corrupt local government, and then it just kind of blah, it poops itself. Like, it just kind of, everything happens at once, and you're forced to know like 12 different characters all with different, and yeah, I agree. I couldn't tell you any of that.
I watched the entire season and I felt myself wanting to, it didn't come in a box, but I wanted to pick up the box and read the back to make sure it was still part of the same franchise.
Mm-hmm.
It the entire season was just fizzled. It just wasn't there.
And it's doubly frustrating because Vince Vaughn, but every single one of the creative team, Justin Lin's a very good director. Nico, I forget his last name, but the creator of the show who wrote it is obviously an incredibly talented writer, and it just didn't coalesce in the way it needed to coalesce. And hopefully if the show does get a season 3-14 years from now, because apparently HBO was saying, yes, take your time, develop it if you want to develop it, which they should have said for season 2,
yeah,
it will come back and have that thunder and that lightning and thunder. Good Lord. I'm a hack writer.
Keep it going. Keep it going.
But it'll have that little sort of sense of lightning in a bottle. There we go. Yeah. That the show originally had when it first came out. I believe that it easily can. It's just, let's make sure it gets there. Then again, I'm the guy who loves season 2 of American Horror Story and think it's an essential television viewing. So.
Wait, which one was 2?
2 was Asylum.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So what are now that we're on that topic, what are your loves and hates when it comes to TV?
My favorites of all time, Twilight Zone, X-Files, Buffy, West Wing, Gilmore Girls, Isle of Lucy. I watch everything. I mean, Mary Tyler Moore Show, I could keep going. Thriller. So many fantastic series. Southland, I think, is incredible. Yes. The Cosby Show,
Have you guys never watched The Honeymooners?
Of course.
Yes, Honeymooners is very, very good.
It's good.
Okay, good.
You got to put the Cosby Show in there. So.
Yeah, Cosby Show, despite cool. the fact that I think it ebbed out a little bit in the last 2 seasons.
Yeah, they're all getting too old. They weren't cute anymore.
Yeah, the episode where with the goldfish, I think, is one of the best episodes of television ever made. Yeah. Just so tons of TV that I absolutely adore in every way. In terms of hating television, is there something where I absolutely loathe everything about it? It's not a specific show. I tend to hate television shows when they fundamentally alter everything that you believe the show is about, simply to do so and to shake stuff up. Like, one of the best TV series of all time is the Norman Lear show Maude that was in the 1970s. It was a spinoff of All in the Family.
Mm-hmm.
It has some of the best episodes of comedic television ever. And then in the last season, in order to get more ratings, Maude leaves all of the supporting characters behind, everyone but her husband, and moves to Washington to become a senator. Ha ha! And that lasts for 4 episodes, and then the series is abruptly canceled. Like, that sort of thing is the thing that really gets under my fucking skin. Because here's a show that covered abortion. It covered abuse within the marriage. It covered drug abuse. It covered all of these real visceral topics. And then all of a sudden it becomes basically a parody of itself. And that's going to be its legacy in the last couple of episodes. That's right there. That said, Norman Lear is a genius. And when he has another TV show, even though he's 90, I surely hope that he hires me on it.
Well, I think a little bit happened of that, like in the 90s with the Roseanne show.
Mm-hmm.
Only to like abruptly in the most I guess, stupid way possible, winning the lottery, coming rich, the one thing that they loathe for most of the all the years, you know?
I know, but if you remember, the series finale redacted that. They said that the last season and a half had been a dream that Roseanne had.
I forgot about that, yeah.
Because John Goodman had died and she couldn't mentally handle it.
A dream. It's always a dream.
Same elsewhere?
I forgot about that one.
Bob Newhart show. Pardon me, Newhart.
That's a great dream, though.
Newhart's good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Clever. Yeah. What's the since on the same line, I always was old school when I was younger, but always like Taxi.
Oh, Taxi's great. Wonderful. Yeah.
That one, and there's one other I had in my I'll think of it in a second.
Who's the Boss?
I liked Who's the Boss. We're getting into nostalgia though, because it's like when I was younger, you know. We got to say Sam. I gotta say Sanford and Sons, because I did love that.
Charlie seems like he's in pain.
Sanford and Sons, yeah, that's what it was.
Yes, whenever he gets a thinking, it starts to burn up there.
Good things start to happen. Shh. Quiet over there, Carlos. Yeah. Another chalupa.
I dare you.
What was the other one? Not coming to me. He'll come to me like toward the end of the show, and I'll just blur it out.
It's fine. I'm known for just saying the words Dolores Van Cartier randomly in a Macy's from time to time.
There it is. What's the show with one of the first gigs for Michael J. Fox? What's that show?
Family Ties.
Was it Family Ties? Yeah.
Were there Democrats and he's a hardcore Republican?
Yeah. I don't know. That one, my mother loved that show, and it was always on.
That's a good one.
Yeah. No. And anything PBS back in the day, you know. Good television.
And then, of course, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. The greatest show of all time.
perfect segue, because you're talking about children's programming, and I wanted to talk to you about Young Storytellers.
Oh, how did you know?
I do research.
Oh, God, real quick. You stalk me on Facebook?
Oh, no. I stalk you on the internet, not just Facebook.
Uh-oh. Here we go.
So now there's a big poster in my wall right there, so every morning we give each other a high five, and you don't even know it.
Oh, I appreciate you.
So there's this a group called Young Storytellers Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us about that?
Yes, it's the greatest foundation in the history of the world. I've worked with them for about 5 years. It's a very simple thing. You just have to devote 1 hour of your week to it. What we do are groups of 10 mentors. I'm normally the head mentor. However, I haven't been able to do it since I've been employed at DreamWorks because of timing. I'm going to start again very, very soon. We go into impoverished schools in the LA area, and we are paired with a group of fifth graders. There are 10 fifth graders, one fifth grader per mentor. And over the course of 8 weeks, the fifth grader writes a 5-page screenplay. The screenplay can cover any topic. We have like The Simpsons versus Star Wars, and then we have like quiet dramas where a student is dealing with an eating disorder and her best friend who has cancer. So they run the gamut from anything to anything. Wow. And then at the end of the 8 weeks, we have professional film and TV stars come in, and we have a big show where they perform the 5-page scripts for the entire school. And the kids become rock stars, basically, for hopefully the rest of their lives. It's wonderful. It promotes literacy with kids. And more than that, it's just fucking fun. It's delightful in every way, shape, and form. Because you're not just playing with kids, but you're learning about yourself. And as weird and corny as that sounds, it's totally true. And then you get to meet superstars at the end. So that's always fun, too.
There's There's another friend of mine. I don't know if you know her, Cheryl Tyrrell.
Nope, but I'm sure she's horrible. Because her name is Cheryl.
This is awesome.
Brutal.
She's actually pretty wonderful, and she works with the Young Storytellers Foundation. So
I had a feeling that's where that story was going, but I just wanted it to take a little detour.
Watch Robert run into Cheryl. 6 months.
Yeah, sure. Don't worry, she doesn't listen to the show either.
Great.
No, Cheryl, I'm sure, is delightful.
Clean up.
So good.
So good.
But anyway.
What I did want to do is go back to talking about working with kids and everything, because I do appreciate this is as serious as I can possibly be.
With a Taco Bell box behind you.
It's over my shoulder like a parrot.
Weird addiction.
Coming from inner city Chicago, where I tell you, there you just don't have any clue that any of this is possible, whether it's making cartoons or writing stories or anything like that. When you're there, there's no escape from poverty. You know, right. Quite honestly, they teach you. My escape was I joined the army. That was my way out of the cyclical not being able to escape. You know, everyone in the city or everyone who's financially challenged in this life doesn't know what's possible. They don't know that you can go to school and learn how to animate and then move to California and eventually work at DreamWorks or something like that. They don't think that there's kind of no real value to your writing unless you're writing about how hungry and starving you are, and then someone feels bad for you, picks up your story and does something with it, right? So when you have something like Young Storytellers who actually goes in and teaches you about writing and lets you know that if you learn how to write, it will make a difference in your life. If you learn how to read these stories, it makes a difference in your life. There's such value to that, that every time I hear something like this, I have to take a couple minutes to just really, really give you as much props as humanly possible, because being one of those kids, you know, growing up in Chicago, the only escape from all of this was playing baseball, playing basketball. You learn how to rhyme, you know, you make music, whatever. So you have to, you know, shuck and jive your way into success. Whereas if you learn how to write, if you learn how to express yourself, if you know that all of these avenues are there, you can then travel those avenues. You don't have to shuck and jive your way through, or even work at a factory for that matter.
Mm-hmm. I am going to tell a very heartwarming story now. That's one of my favorite memories from Young Storytellers. So, Jack, this is not the time for you to have an awkward cough. Oh, he just gave a thumbs up for those listening at home. But,
and then Charlie mutes himself and coughs.
One time I had a student, he was being mentored by, I think her name was Trilby, and he was the quietest kid. We could barely get him to talk, to tell his story. He kept switching ideas a bunch of times. And the story that he finally settled on was a story where this kid wanted to get to a concert that his brother was at, but in order to get to his brother, he had to go through gang territory. And it was a fun story. They ended up like having a dance off with the gang because one of the only things that the students can't use in their stories is we don't do violence. We say we're above that. And we try and come up with more creative ways for characters to settle their conflicts. So that was what the story was about. We were all very, very proud of the story. It went over really, really well. We had, I think, Nathan Fillion was playing one of the parts, and Alexis Bledel, and John Hamm was there that day. It was a fantastic big show. And then after it was over, you know, the kids are all taking pictures with the actors, and I saw the little boy, and he was waving at, I quickly realized, was his older brother, who was 17 or 18. And the older brother had a bullseye tattoo on his right eye. So it looked like his right eye was in a bullseye. And the older brother was like in tears. And he was a very, very tough, gruff-looking guy. Not the kind of guy who one would expect to be tearing up at a elementary school. And I saw the little brother run to the big brother, and they were hugging, and they were both crying. And the older brother says, I finally get it, and I'm sorry, and we're going to figure it out together. And I didn't realize that you knew what I was doing. And I assume that the brother had joined a gang and didn't know that the little brother realized that he was putting his life out there every single day. And the little boy and the brother, for the next 2 years that I was at that school, every big show, he and his big brother came to the show to just watch it and enjoy it, and they came together. And it was one of the most heartwarming things that I've ever seen. And again, it was one of those quiet kids who you would never expect to just blossom in the way that he did. So anyway, back to the dick and fart jokes. And the Taco Bell.
Oh, that's amazing.
But yeah, it's truly one of the greatest programs, and it's only an hour a week. So everyone listening, I highly recommend that, just give it a shot. It's fun, and you get to play like a kid for an hour a week.
Is that nationwide?
We're currently in LA and New York, and I believe we're opening some stuff up in Chicago and Miami in the next couple of months to a year.
Oh, nice. Is there any qualifications that a mentor, I guess, you would?
Nope. We take everyone.
As long as you can read and write? I'm assuming?
Yes, as long as you can read and write. Because you're going to be transcribing the script for the kid.
And then what's the ultimate goal for these lessons that you're teaching these kids? Is it to get them published in a way? Or?
Well, we have the big show, which was the end of it previously. But now we're actually following the students as they go from fifth grade to eighth grade, and now we have high school programs as well, where the students are morphing, creating new stories, and learning about filmmaking in the high school classes, and ultimately making their own quote-unquote first features. Again, we bring in film and TV actors to do that stuff. Those programs are about a year or two old, so they're fairly in their infancy a bit, but we had the program just for fifth grade. And one of the things that our wonderful leader, Bill Thompson, has said is he wants to make sure that we stick with the students as they grow older as well. So it's not just the lessons are taught and then the students are left on their own. We have to stick with them. So
yes. So many other programs have found the value in doing that. I was in a program growing up doing the same thing, for computer programming and graphics, and it ends up staying with the kids through graduating. Even got a scholarship at the end, little money at the end for school and stuff like that. The Black Data Processing Associates for me, in back where I grew up. But yeah, it's kind of cool. I volunteer and help teach at an art center here in Chicago called Marwin, where it's fully backed by just philanthropy. And like they take kids from the inner city and they allow them to be exposed to different types of the arts and stuff like that. But they follow those kids through because they can stay in those classes. So yeah, maybe you start as a fifth grader, but you know, you stay with them all the way through high school. So it's kind of cool to stay with the kids. It gives them helps those kids make it, so to speak. So probably about 2 years, you're gonna have some good high school graduates on your hands there, Robert.
Because kids will pick up on that real fast. Like if you are with a kid for, you know, a summer, mm-hmm. they're like, you're only gonna do this, and when I'm done here, you're not gonna care. Yeah. So when you actually go from year to year and you follow them through and you check in on them, they start to understand that people do care about their well-being, and they're going mm-hmm. to they're going to give more to you.
Yeah. And Marwin finds that those kids do come back, you know. So even the classes that I've taught, you see the same kids come back. And then what happens is it's kind of similar to like kids going to like Sunday school or church or whatever, they start to bring their families involved. They start to bring their families to the art shows and stuff like that. And then their little sisters all of a sudden wants to get involved too. So now you change that one kid's life, but now it's having an effect on their whole family. And siblings and cousins, they start bringing out, because then parents start talking, and then the parents start acting different, because usually you see parents and they're a little standoffish in the beginning, but then, you know, they start coming back, and, you know, it's a great way to build community.
I concur.
Jack, you want to take the soapbox for a second?
I unfortunately don't have much on this. I feel like a terrible person not volunteering in kids programming, but it's all right. I'll be the bad guy. I got nothing to add to this.
Jack, be our segue man.
I don't have one.
Do you want a segue?
I do.
Do you know what time it is?
I do.
Professional writer Robert Taylor. This or that. This is your life. No, this or that. When you're brainstorming and you're getting into your writing groove, do you use a pencil or a pen?
That's your lead off.
Wow, we're very.
Don't worry, they only get worse.
I use a Sharpie marker and note cards, so none of the above.
Really?
Talk to us about that. Like, what's your creative process like?
Well, I usually shoot the shit with the other writers in the writer's room, and then when I'm crafting a story, I like to put ideas that I have on note cards. So I just write down every idea that I have, put it on the table, and then I can shuffle around until they are in the proper order, deleting stuff, putting stuff in. Carlos is busy cleaning up his Taco Bell, and I've just realized that his hat says C for Carlos.
That's right. Because
he's not narcissistic at all.
Nope. And the back says greatest ever. No, I was actually going to share with you. I have this. Do you have an iPad?
Not. It's dead. I have an iPhone.
I was going to share with you a little app that I find useful, and I forget that I have it until I need it. Oh, here it is. It's called, here we go with the jokes, Corkulous Pro.
It's what?
Say it one more time.
Corkulous?
Corkulous. Pro. P-R-O.
That's Sesame Street right there.
Yeah. So basically, you have this, you might not even be able to see, but I'll describe it. Imagine a corkboard, a digital corkboard, and you can add post-it notes and little pictures and all kinds of stuff. And it's wonderful for brainstorming because you can kind of like what you're talking about. You write a bunch of things and on postcards and then, or whatever the hell, and then you move them around. This, you can do the same thing. You can like click and move different parts. And I'm sad that you can't see. Anyway, moving on.
The weird thing is every single time you start to pull it away is the second that it, we can start to see it.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's see.
Wait for it.
There yep, we go. Yeah. All right. So we got it.
Yes, it seems delightful.
But it only stays up if you have the program open.
You're able to take these little post-it notes and drag them all around. So mm-hmm.
Looks like Robert's office.
Yeah.
Robert, you've been replaced.
Digitally. There we go. Focus. So yeah, so anyway, you can add images to it. You can put notes on those little post-it notes. You can do all kinds of things and move them around. And I just remembered that app because of what you just said.
So what you're saying is I should delete Fruit Ninja and replace it with that.
This is what's cool. You can do both.
I love how something has to go.
We are at that point, my friend.
Something has to be sacrificed. Yeah, me too. It's the story of iPhone, yeah.
All I get is storage is full. It's something's got to go.
And your iCloud's full too, right?
Yeah. On a related note.
Yes.
Hang on one second. Talk amongst yourselves. What? Hey.
This is live.
Yeah, that. So you said a big... You said a big a Sharpie is what you said. Oh, here we go. So on a related note, because you said Fruit Ninja and such, I just wanted to let you guys know that I'm in level 1838 in Candy Crush. 1838 Candy Crush 2017. Moving on.
We're all very proud of you. That's what he wants us to say, right?
Yes, exactly.
The game designer here is telling
your mother is not
playing that game. There's no end.
Your mother is disappointed that this is what your life has become.
I'm disappointed that you're still playing the game.
She actually just texted me and told me to put my computer away.
Yes. Mom knows best.
Hey!
Tell your mother I say hi. I'm sure she'd adore me.
I said that before. Your mom.
Hey, Robert, would you rather write for TV or film?
Both, but television.
I'm available.
Plug. Keep going.
All right. Proper sentence structure. Would you rather play with the subject or the predicate?
Oh, boy. Getting dirty.
Subject. Hey guys, there's no need to subject me to that. Oh god, it's 10:41 at night. I apologize for that. Let's just all pretend like Charlie did it. We'll just silently assume that really? Charlie said that. Yes.
Yes.
This is what we do?
Okay. Yeah, it is.
Story of my life.
All right, so when we're in school, we were learned that there are three essential skills that you need to be successful: reading, writing, and arithmetic. Since you have writing covered, would you read or write? Read or arithmetic?
Would you arithmetic?
Would you arithmetic? Your English on the show is amazing.
Just wait for the Spanish to come out.
Maybe we can try that.
Ay, Dios mío. I would pick reading.
Because he doesn't know how to arithmetic.
Ay, Dios mío. We have a show title.
In fact, I would go so far to say as 90% of the writers who work in Hollywood know nothing about math.
Especially when it comes to paychecks. All right, last one. Would you rather love Lucy in New York or love Lucy in LA?
New York. You forgot when she moved to Connecticut for the last two seasons of the show.
No, I didn't. Oh, yeah. I didn't. Because they had the farm in the back. Fred and Ethel lived next door.
No, they lived in the guest house. Get it together, motherfucker.
That's right. Damn. Well, it's technically next door.
He knows.
There's going to be too many more motherfuckers, motherfucker.
He knows this looks even step back.
I know. Jeepers.
And don't even get me started about the three seasons worth of hour-long specials.
Are you serious? Wow.
Talk to me.
We love Lucy. Now that show.
Apparently. and then there was the Lucio Ball show.
There was?
No, it was just called The Lucy Show.
The Lucy Show.
Oh, yeah. They're as not good as much of The Lucy Show is. There is one episode of The Lucy Show, which, if you are a fan of Lucy at all, you owe it to yourself to watch. Jack, have you ever seen Lucy and Viv put in a shower?
I don't think so, but that sounds awesome.
Oh, my God, girl.
Vivian Vance?
Yes, it was one of the early seasons while Vivian Vance was still there.
Amazing.
The premise of the episode is, wait for it, they put in a shower. And... it has this sequence in it that's about 10 minutes where, and they have to do all of this logic shuffling to get here, but it's totally worth it. They're putting in the shower and Lucy accidentally turns on the water and the water won't turn off and they get trapped in the shower and the water is slowly rising until 8 feet deep. And Lucy and Viv are trapped and swimming in it. And it's about to overflow. And there's something absolutely wonderful about seeing these two women who actually reacting to the fact that the water is rising. Because there's only so... all of the other ones, Vitamita Vegemin, the candy, the Italian stomping the grapes, those were all so rehearsed, but... there's something lovely about this one because there's real water spraying them in the face and getting up their nose. And then they're running into one another. And there's one part where Lucille Ball accidentally lets go of the side of the shower and goes underneath for a good like 3 or 4 seconds. And you're like, oh, dear Lord.
That's how we lose her.
Yes. A wonderful, wonderful episode, and I can't highly recommend it enough. And Jack, you should watch it tonight, and we'll discuss tomorrow if you decide to talk to me.
I've already got it queued up. I'm just waiting for this show to be over.
Well, is that your subtle hint for saying that we should wrap it up?
Not at all.
Not at all.
Because I think Carlos wants to go get some more tacos.
No, Carlos is good. I'm trying to find a picture because... I went to go see the I Love Lucy stage play.
Oh, that was it. I wanted to go desperately. Oh, it was completely sold out for the entire run.
You guys really like I Love Lucy. This is like really...
it's a magical show. The stage play itself was...
it's I Love Lucy when she has the eye drops, right?
No.
Are you calling me a liar?
Yeah.
Ooh. Ooh.
By the way, your mother just texted me and said I'm her favorite. So here's a picture. I'm going to see if you guys can see that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's me and Fred. Not Fred. That's me. And
it might be Fred.
It might be for all we know. San Francisco. No. It's me and Lucy and Ethel and Ethel was really going for it. She was trying to kiss me in the mouth. I was like, dude, my wife is right there. What are you doing? My wife, and meaning she was Lucy, like, cause I was the Cuban in the middle. So yeah, anyway, the stage play itself is really, it's really cool. It's like you're the live studio audience when they're recording the actual show. And then they have these old looking cameras, and so they have the different, you know, they have the Ricky's nightclub is one of the scenes, and then the other scene is when they're in the living room in the kitchen, and then there's another scene. Anyway, so there's three scenes that the stage play itself is pretending like they're shooting for NBC, right? And mm-hmm. and they have the director yelling cut and the cameraman and everything, and they do the scene, and then between the scenes they have these little commercials that happen. So they had this lady run out in the Alka-Seltzer commercial mm-hmm. outfit, and she's singing and swinging her little Alka-Seltzer baton and stuff, and it was really clever. It was a really good really good show. So if you guys ever have a chance to go see the I Love Lucy stage play, knock that out. It's wonderful.
Every time it comes here, it's sold out immediately.
As well it should. It is that good.
Jack, I'm going to put you in charge of getting us tickets.
I've got it queued up right now. I'm just waiting for the show to be over.
Oh, Jack.
All right. It's just called the I Love Lucy stage play?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I can totally picture Jack just starting to watch it. Like, he puts in some headphones, he mutes us out.
Yeah,
he's actually 4 minutes into the Lucy Show episode right now.
He's already into the fifth episode of Crazy Ex-Girlfriend Show. Okay. Unless we have more questions for Robert, we can move into... Wanna have you hear me? For me this week, we're going to be talking about Sean Ivey. Sean is an illustrator. And there's a couple reasons why I wanted to talk about Sean. Number one, he's got mad skills. Yeah, his skills are
mad,
just super mad. So he draws on, it looks like it's on brown paper, and he does traditional. He'll sketch and then he'll paint, and it looks fantastic because drawings just always look better on brown paper for whatever reason.
Yeah,
everything looks better brown, if you ask me. But
yeah, a lot darker brown.
But one of the reasons I wanted to point him out was because this. So before I forget, Ivy Illustration, Instagram.com/IVIE Illustration.
Scroll down. Is that paper bags?
Yeah, brown paper. So if you were listening, you would have heard me say brown paper.
No, nuts. Look up. It looked like there's a paper bag in that picture. I wordless.
This, my friends, is his lovely wife. And she was diagnosed with cancer. And I don't know the full story, but she just finished the first round of chemo. And they're trying to collect money to help pay for the medical bills.
Mm-hmm.
And so what he's doing is, for $15, he'll do a single sketch for you. And that money goes directly to helping his family not go in debt. Thank you, Trump. Moving on. So yeah, and dude is mad talented. So... the sketches that you'll get are high quality, and you will be helping him and his family. So that is Instagram.com/IVIE Illustration. Handle that.
All right.
Next.
Go on, Charles. You're always next.
Charles.
Okay. Cool. Let me share my screen.
Sharing screens.
Let's see. Tell me when it shares, because I hit the button.
And ain't nobody trying to see your face.
Face amazing.
Wait, we have to stop looking. We have to stop looking at Charlie's handsome mug. What the hell? No. No.
Exactly.
You All right. Look so... at it, but you'll turn into stone.
You're going to be cheering when my screen changes.
Wow.
You gorgeous bastard.
These haters. Haters going to hate. Anyway. So.
Haters going to wait for you to hurry up and share your screen.
Sharing it. No, nuts. Quiet. All right. So my artist is a 3D artist this week. He's from Shanghai, China. His name is Hilong Zhu. He's like a digital sculptor. One of the reasons why I like him is because he experiments with a lot of different renders. He has a knack for things that are like photorealistic as well as just framed really nice. And then the detail in his models are pretty amazing, you know. From an artistic standpoint, so I like him. It's pretty straightforward this week.
Your microphone just went crazy, dude.
Charlie just went into the Matrix.
Charlie is Will Smith.
Fair enough. Is it still bad?
Nope, you're good.
Yeah. So. He just has a really, really he's one of those guys that throws everything at the model, including kitchen sink. It's just like his details really got nice. So he's one of my favorite ones that I keep on follow. And I like him. He's really good. So check him out. Does he have an Instagram too? I think he might. No, he does not. He's one of those reclusive dudes. Nope. So yeah, check out his art station.
One of those reclusive dudes.
Yeah. Well, his name once again is Hilong Zhu. So I'll send the link. It'll be in the show notes. And if I butchered your name, I apologize. But
how do you go back? Zhelou.
Yeah. Let me go back since you want me to go back. Zhelong.
Long. Last name is Xu.
XU. Z
will be on the show notes.
Hilong.artstation.com. Check him out. He is amazeballs. Very like museum ancient
history. And if you're listening on iTunes, this dude has like dragons and little characters all over the place.
Yeah. And Charlie, can I also say I appreciate you for using the word amazeballs?
Thank you. Thank you.
What are you two, like, in cahoots or something? What's going on here?
Yo, don't be jealous. Just
I am.
Just deal with it.
Friend me on Facebook, Charlie. We'll chat. We'll chat.
Yeah, this is awesome. Thank you. I most definitely will. We can talk about these two knuckleheads.
Hey, Jack, text me and we can chat.
You guys already talk. Shut up.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Yeah, moving on. Jack, all you.
All right. Hey, Jack, can I see your screen? Because it's amazeballs.
That sounded like...
All right, speaking of sculpture.
Pause.
But this is real sculpture. None of that 3D stuff. Ellen Jewett's Jewett.
Is this taxidermy?
No.
You gonna go there? You gonna go there, Jack?
Thanks. Go where? Go where?
You just cut down 3D.
Dude, I work in 3D. Chill out.
This is true.
Alternative facts. Sorry.
Now, I got to say that her price tags are pretty impressive.
Oh, my gosh. $4,000?
So they're all handmade. These are like one-offs. They're not die-casted. They're not, you know, I don't even know what. I think they're mixed medium made out of, you know, whatever she can find. Some are clay. Some are... probably real feathers and leaves and whatnot. Come on. But the texture and like sculptural detail she's got going on is pretty impressive for for how I don't know the size of these.
So how about that?
I think they range. I've seen like a gallery photo of them, and some of them are about like a foot.
$7,000. I better write that thing to work.
That's big then. $7,000.
Yeah. But she's always incorporating these kind of, I don't even know what you'd call it, but these kind of skeletal tree branch root system kind of break off. It's like organic matter of organic matter. But
it's gorgeous stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know who the hell would have this in their house, but
a little creepy. It's gorgeous, but it's a little creepy.
It's pretty impressive skill set.
Yeah,
this is here. This is a little more traditional. The one I can't click on, right?
Okay. Right.
So
it's old.
Anyway, Ellen Jewett, JEWETT.
Jewett. Sculpture.com. I like that one. That's cool. I'd sculpt that one.
Yeah.
How'd you find that, Jack? That's a pretty
you know, I think it came up on a Pinterest page, actually. I got it in my life.
Charlie was about to fall asleep until you said that word. And then, I'm awake.
I mean, I'm about to go follow Jack's Pinterest page. Obviously I'm missing stuff. It's not in my life.
Robert, is there an author out there that we should maybe be on the lookout for?
Well, I actually came up with a sculptor who I actually wanted to talk a little bit about.
Ooh, share your screen. Let's get that done.
Well, I have never done Google Hangouts before, so I don't know how to share my screen. But if one of you fine gentlemen could please look up either Anna Hyatt Hutchinson or Brook Green Gardens, I'll tell you a little bit about her. She's the sculptress from turn of the century to the 1950s. She mostly worked in animal sculpture. And she's truly one of the coolest human beings I have ever read anything about. When I was vacationing in... Are we all doing it? Okay, perfect. Thank you so much, Carlos. You're now my favorite. Sorry.
Yes.
Take
that, Mom.
It does not have the thing that I want to see. Can you just Google Brook Green Gardens fighting stallions real quick?
Sure.
Some of the coolest animal sculpture I've ever seen. And she's an amazing human being. What she did, the Brook Green Gardens that you're seeing, like, check out those fighting fucking horses. I mean, that's pretty impressive.
For the record, they're just fighting. They're not, you know, not fornicating.
I mean, that's pretty neat. So what she did in the 1940s, she and her husband were super duper rich. And so they went down to South Carolina and they bought a group of five plantations, and then they converted them into this free sculpture garden. And they utilized all of the old architecture from the plantations and instead were using it to basically create, yeah, perfect. See how awesome the detail on that those two horses are.
Yeah.
They, in Brook Green Gardens, created a free zoo so that students of students of sculpture could come and learn right there. They also have riverboat cruises, so that you can go out to different parts in the wild to sculpt. And the sculpture in Brook Green Gardens is, by and large, some of the coolest shit you will ever see. A lot of it is animal-based, but they also have a ton of more modernist sculpture as well. And if you're ever in South Carolina, it's definitely worth a visit or four. Robert, it's one of my favorite places to go to. Oh,
so you've been there, okay.
And it's also haunted out the ass. They have wrecks out into the more what's the word I'm looking for? The more overgrown sections of the plantations where the old plantation owners' houses burned down during the Civil War and stuff like that. And I love a good ghost story. So it's always fun to go there. Plus,
Ghost stories. We got to share one real quick. Everybody, make it up if you don't have one.
Okay, before we do that, do we all believe? Thank you, by the way, so much, Carlos. You rock.
I try.
So that's my person, Anna Hyatt Hutchinson, and I agree that we should end with some super awesome ghost stories. Jack, are you just asking me because you know I told you my apartment's haunted?
No, I like ghost stories too.
Who wants to go first?
I'll go first because I enjoy talking. So, my apartment is haunted. Fun story. I never really believed in ghosts before I moved out here. And my apartment that I'm currently in, it's the first apartment I ever looked at while I was in LA. I'm in this fantastic building in Koreatown called the Langham. It was built in the 1920s by Al Jolson. It used to be a luxury hotel. And the woman who was in my apartment prior to myself, by the way, it's $950 utilities and parking included, so suck it.
I'm impressed.
Dang. In LA.
And there's a pool on the roof. Y'all just Google the Langham Apartments Koreatown and you will turn green with envy. So the apartment I moved into, I found out after the fact the previous tenant had been this 90-something-year-old woman who unfortunately had anal cancer and committed suicide by taking a bunch of pills. And I was like, oh, she's not going to haunt my ass. So I don't know if it's her or not. But somebody else. So, the story involves Taco Bell. So, Carlos, perk up. One day, about 6 months after I moved into the what?
Talk about haunting my ass.
Zing. Oh. One day I was coming home with my T-Bell, as one does. This was about 6 months after I moved in. I walked into the kitchen, and again, I truly didn't believe in ghosts until this moment. And I saw a shadow hovering in front of my cereal cabinet. And I thought to myself, that's not good. So I dropped my Taco Bell, and the shadow, moved toward me and ostensibly threw me. I didn't feel, the shivers, and I didn't, see the eyes, or it didn't try and communicate with me or anything, but it scared the fuck out of me, and I went to Jesus so many times that night, guys. I mean, it was ridiculous. And thank you for the mercy laugh, Jack. So about every 6 or 8 months or so, something weird-ish happens in the apartment. When I had a friend over, we were watching a movie on the bed together, and we had a wine glass sitting on my DVD shelf, and it, no earthquake or anything, fell, and it managed to fall 8 inches away from my cabinet, which, again, totally weird and crazy. The scariest thing that has ever happened, and again, I don't feel as if there's any reason for me to, although if I die tomorrow, it was the ghost. Let's be real, it was Jack, but it could have been the ghost. But the freakiest thing that ever happened to me, the one that stayed with me more than anything, was one morning I woke up, and I have 4 closets in my living room area because it used to be a hotel, and so there were trundle beds. So I woke up and I walked in, and every single one of my closet doors was not just open a little bit, completely open, which was very unsettling. So, again, I never believed in ghosts, and now I do. And as my
now
friend,
you know Marta why Kauffman you only said, pay $950 a month.
Yes. I'm in a Poltergeist remake and I don't even know it, guys.
Robert puts a helmet on his head and he gets pushed from one end of the kitchen to the other.
It would be a fun ride. All right, let me pick who gets to go next.
What if we don't have ghost stories? What if we don't have a ghost story?
Then you will make one up. I pick Jack.
I legit don't have a ghost story. That's why I was like, ooh, ghost stories. Let's hear them. I can't make one up. I can't make one up on the spot.
Well, that's a fucking letdown.
Yeah. Isn't it though? It really is.
If I know that this is a podcast and so we should keep talking, but if we are silent and just stare at Jack on the Google Hangout long enough, I think that we will either make him sweat enough to come up with something.
You don't know me well enough.
Or that ghost that's hiding in his closet will come out and actually tell the story for him.
Anyway, fine. If Jack wants to be a spoil sport, let's talk Charlie.
Let's see. I don't have any ghost stories either. I mean,
really? Because your closet door is open.
The weird closet door thing. Oh, thank you. Good segue. Yo, I hate you, Jack. So, like, one of the very first podcasts that we had on here, our good friend Tyrus Gaucher talked about the weird happenings that you read about on the internet about people that show up to people's doors, like kids that have like black eyes and stuff like this. And so, like, last year, in July of 2016, I bought my first house. This house was built in about 1930 or so. So it's got all the old school crown molding and charm. And out of all the rooms in the house, this room here is about the oldest looking, you know, complete with like the lantern light on the wall over there, which you can't really tell because it's lit. But this door, which goes to,
it looks like dead babies are gonna come rolling out right now.
The crawl space in between my house.
The crawl space
between my my roof. I have one of those traditional brick homes here in Chicago, so with a really large slanted roof, as you can see my walls here. We can see it's all slanted and stuff. But legit, I thought of Jack and Carlos and Tyrus the first time I walked into this room. And I was like,
you bought it anyway?
That might be a deal breaker. Because, like, I opened the door for you.
See, this is when it happens. He gets sucked in.
I'm just kidding. Yeah. It's just, there's nothing there but the very first podcast.
In the immortal words of Whoopi Goldberg in the classic Ghost, Molly, you in danger, girl.
Yeah.
Wait, hold up.
Molly, you in danger, girl.
Oh, yes, no.
Nice.
How the hell
do you have that?
Sweet baby Jesus, you are a sound genius.
But it's funny.
One more time, Jack.
One more time.
Molly, you in danger, girl.
And that's the first thing they said in my first podcast in this room. I was all happy and I was all like excited, and they was like, wait a minute, you can't talk to us without talking to us about that door behind you. And injected the doorbell. And then after that conversation, little weirded out about the door. So I have a new desk, as you can see down there, that I need to put together, and probably I'll be facing this way.
Just to make sure if those children under the stairs come after you.
It seems like a special door from that little person who's the murderer in the red coat in Don't Look Now. Like, that's where she spends her off season. She vacations in Venice, and then she comes back and hangs out there.
It was like the John Malkovich
sharpening her knives.
Yeah.
So funny.
Carlos.
All right. So this is a true story, but it didn't happen to me. It happened to a couple friends of mine. High school age, a friend of mine in high school, her grandmother passed away in this room in her family's house. I have a couple of them. Anyway, so her grandma passed away, and then to kind of cheer her up, her mom and dad let her throw a party, and that's, you know, all these high school kids came over having a good time and everything. Without really, no one really knew what happened to her grandma or where it happened or anything. We just knew, everyone knew that she needed cheering up, and everyone was there. And this couple kids had gone into the room that is now vacant. And then, so she goes in, the girl goes in, and they're just kind of talking, nothing really, anything about her grandmother or anything. And this kid that's always, he was always the practical joker, always, you know, just being goofy. He walked in and he looked around, and in a weird look on his face, he goes, "Is this where it happened?" And he didn't know anything. And she's like, "What do you mean?" And he's like, "I don't know." And she's like, "Yeah, this is the room where my grandma passed away," and everyone left.
"You're gonna die in there."
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, I was talking to Charlie.
We can be here. So then, God, there's a couple of them. So I'm convinced that my dog Lucy sees ghosts.
Oh, that's my ghost story. Lame, but go ahead.
Jack, you have already given up the opportunity to have a ghost story.
I know.
Right now we're listening to Carlos's much better story.
You're right. Go ahead.
So I have a sister that lives down in the LA area, and she had, well, the house that they lived in, weird things always happened. So like my little niece, she's about 6 or 7 now. She would always freak out because she said that there's monsters that would come out of the heating ducts and stuff, right? The vents. And everyone was like, "This little girl, like, she's got a weird imagination." But then weird things would happen, like doors would open and everyone was asleep. Or weird noises would happen and everyone was asleep, right? And so Lucy and I came and we were visiting them for the weekend or whatever. I was sleeping on the couch, and my niece, the older one, took Lucy into her bedroom and they were sleeping in the bedroom. Well, Lucy, who's generally a pretty well-behaved dog, she woke up in the middle of the night and started barking at like the gap between the TV and the VCR. And she was just going, and all of her back hairs were standing up. And I was like, "What the hell?" So I ran upstairs and I was like, "What's going on?" And my niece said, "I don't know. She just woke up and like was staring at that gap and was barking very aggressively." And I was like, "Lucy, it's cool. Like, lay down." And so they both laid down. Lucy laid down, but she didn't go to sleep. She just sat there staring at that gap in that area and just kept kind of growling. And then,
"Get out the house. You're about to die. Don't you realize you're in a horror movie, dude?"
I know.
No, she's just like, reminding you to set your DVR. She's barking at the cable box.
She's like, "Gilmore Girls is coming on." So then I go back to the couch, I laid back down, and then just as soon as I laid down, Lucy jumps out of the bed and starts barking and growling at that area between the TV and the VCR. And so my niece comes downstairs and says, hey, can you come up and sleep with me in my bed? Cause I'm freaked out. And I said, I don't know how to tell you this. I love you, but you need to go ahead and lay down on this other couch. Because ain't no way in hell I'm going to be going up there with you where there's ghosts and shit. Lucy's freaked out. I'm more freaked out than her. And so, yeah, that's the other one.
I feel as if at least three of the four of us should be dead at this point.
Yeah. And there's the other one where my grandmother was staying with my mom. She had cancer of the everything. And I had a Cocker Spaniel at the time. And my grandmother was like obviously deathly ill in her room. And my mom had laid down in her room. And my dog, who never jumped on the bed, went into my mom's room and jumped on the bed. And my mom was like, Brandy, get down, get down. So Brandy would get down, but then she came back up and jumped up. And my mom was like, this dog never gets on the bed. And then when you tell her to get off, she never jumps back on. So she's like, let me go see. So she went in, and my grandma had passed away. And then when all of us were there, we were all, you know, we're all holding hands and praying and stuff like that. Brandy kept looking up on the top corner of the room and was fixated there. So we think that my grandma was kind of like there watching us pray.
There's that wonderful story that Stephen King put in that sequel to The Shining, the Dr. Sleep book, where he had heard this story about this cat who lived in an old folks home. And the cat would always know when someone was about to die. It would always go to the person's room and lay on the bed. And it got to the point where, and it would just be sometimes they were completely healthy, and yet the cat would somehow always know.
Does the cat know, or does the cat cause it?
Maybe it's a death cat.
Can be.
Cat be knocking on, right when the cat knocks on your door, you're like,
Can we also just talk about if you're listening to this, if you're listening to it, you're not noticing, but Charlie has intensely started to look over his shoulder about every 40 seconds.
He totally has.
You guys, like, for real, real.
Mm-hmm. Ah, so good.
Well, Jack did the whole knocking there. And I was like,
"That's not knocking. It's."
Can we come in?
That wasn't even Jack. That was.
Jack. You know what?
Nobody else heard that besides Charlie.
Just me.
Stop playing the sound effects, Jack.
Go, Jackson.
The other thing I have to say is, so, Charlie, I know that you've been busy doing a podcast or whatever, but I still haven't gotten the friend request, and I'm just saying.
And he really wants to chat.
Okay.
Because I have some opinions.
I bet you know what? I bet your Facebook feed is amazing in terms of your opinions daily.
Look, I'm not narcissistic in any way, but thank you and yes.
Yeah.
Guilty as charged.
Anyway, well, anyone have any short and sweet final questions for me? Because it's 11:21 and Daddy needs his beauty sleep.
1:21 here. I got you beat.
Look, if we're going to one-up one another, no, I'm kidding.
We're not. Well, yo, lasting advice. We always ask that, you know, advice that you would give, you know, usually comes different on our show, straight talk. What would you give?
I mean, I think that, if someone is trying to break into screenwriting, the other bit of advice that I would give them that I is one of the hardest bits of advice to take mm-hmm. is if you're not feeling good about a project and you're doing it simply because you think that it will make you, don't mm-hmm. do it, because you'll end up regretting it. And even though every iota of your being might be telling you to stick with it, if it's something that, if it's with a bunch of dicks, and I'm not talking about, you know, it being a porn movie, I'm saying if it's with a bunch of assholes, and I'm not talking about right. it being porn, if right. it's with a bunch of vaginas, and I'm not talking about porn, but if it's with a bunch of people who you don't want to spend 2 years of your life developing stuff with, you have to give yourself the freedom to say, this is not for me, I'm walking away. Because I guarantee that you'll be wasting months or years of your life on something that's not going to be creatively fulfilling for you. You should, on your own, do something that's super duper awesome. And it's difficult. Everyone's been in that position before, and everyone's ended up wasting time before. But I'm telling you that it's okay. Jack, it's okay.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you.
I have one last question.
Uh-oh.
As a writer, do you have good handwriting?
Yes.
I'm done.
Do most writers?
No.
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 All right. So there.
There it
so,
is.
Hey, Robert, if people were looking for you online and I don't know.
Well, Charlie's not. So what's the fucking point?
Well, you know, the friend request has been there for a good hot 5 minutes. But I'm just throwing that out there. You sign up for my Pinterest page. See, we'll talk about that in a second.
It's 1 minute, motherfucker. 1 minute.
You're gonna check. You're gonna fact check.
Live fact checking.
Okay, I don't need your alternative facts here.
Oh God.
Well, if someone were to find me, they could look me up on Facebook. I don't Insta. I don't twat. I don't. a couple of years ago, I watched all of the AFI Top 100 films on a very narcissistically titled blog called BobTaylorRocks.blogspot.com. But the articles are delightful, and I would highly recommend that you read them. I will be having a website that's launched in the next month and a half or so. I watched all of Akira Kurosawa's movies chronologically and wrote 3,000-word articles about each. And when the website goes live, I think it's going to be fun and exciting. And also, I might get some death threats. So that should be interesting. But in general, if you want to find me, you have to look.
Robert Taylor.
I don't come to you. You come to me. Charlie. Thank you, Jack.
Great.
Oh my God, this is so nice. Hey, Charlie, if people are looking for you online, say Robert Taylor.
Well, he won't be looking for me. But if all the listeners want to find me, you can find me on my website, www.cargocollective.com/CharlieBWilliams. You can find me on Facebook, facebook.com/CharlieBW3. I can't talk today. No, I'm forgetting which one it is. You can find me on Twitter at CBW3, Instagram, CharlieBW3, Almighty Pinterest, CharlieBW3.
Get your life right.
Get it in your life. Jesus Christ. Come on now, Carlos. Do this every week.
Oh, hey, Jack.
Yes, as always, I am at sketchbookjack.com and sketchbookjack everywhere else: Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and Charlie's friend Pinterest.
Which co-sponsored Jack's post today. Yeah.
It's true.
Thank you all for being on the show. I am Carlos Gomez. You can find me at carlosrgomez.com or in the social medias, Coconut Justice. This is Sketch Zone. You can find us at sketch.zone. And if you have a suggestion for a guest, go to sketch.zone/guest on Twitter. You were going to say?
I was going to say, I look forward to coming back for the 100th episode.
Like I did that.
If you're on Twitter.
It takes a lot to have Carlos speak this.
I was pausing for dramatic effect. I was waiting for him to call me another name. If you're on Twitter, you can find us at Sketch Zone. If you're on Facebook and speak English, you can go to facebook.com/thesketchzone.
What the hell kind of a dig was that?
Because I tripped on my words.
Why are you exposing his English again, Jack? Leave him alone.
And no, it sounded like if you're on Facebook and speak English.
I tripped on my words.
Leave him alone.
Facebook.com/thesketchzone.
Carlos, I have faith. Concentrate.
We can go to youtube.com/sketchzonepodcast. And we're also on Stitcher, SoundCloud, Google Play Music, and iTunes. Subscribe on iTunes. And if you're there and you leave us a review, we'll read it on the show. We'll actually have Robert Taylor come back and dramatically read your review of the show because he can read. Hey.
And speak English.
If you're on YouTube, if you're watching this on YouTube, we need you to subscribe because we're trying to get as many subscribers as possible so we can do a Sketch Zone show live in one of the YouTube studios. Oh, and I have some news. I don't know if I can announce it.
Probably not.
That was a tease.
Maybe next week. It's not a Sketch Zone thing.
You did not just pull a Charlie.
He did.
It's not a Sketchstone thing. It's a Midway thing. Some really cool things are happening with Midway.
Don't be DJ Risky Business. Don't do that. No. You better confirm. What up, DJ Risky? I love you, Sam. Just saying.
Get out of here with that. Risky's always stealing people's thunder. Anyway. I love that dude, though.
Well, I just... Okay.
It's true. I call them out on it every time. So that's it for us, y'all. It's 11:30 here, and I have to get up super early. So have a good week.
Good night, all.
See you guys next week.
This has been delightful.
you ruined my end tag. Only Robert could have done it.
What's the end tag?
You heard it.
Molly, you in danger, girl.